Hi, everyone. I'm Barbara Beck, and I want to thank you for tuning in to Welcome Home. Today's program is going to be super interesting and one which many of you will relate to. You know, when we talk about redemption, what does that mean to you? How about the big word restoration? Well, if you're a Christian, then you probably are very familiar with those terms. Christ redeemed us at the cross when He literally paid for our sins with His life. And then the work of restoring our lives began. Well, on today's program, we have a great example of a man whose life was redeemed and restored, but not without a great deal of brokenness, bottoming out, and ultimately surrendering to the power of Jesus Christ in his life. I'm going to be talking to one of our own, Good Life 45's producer of Welcome Home, and he will share how God took his life from ashes to beauty. You'll want to hear his story, and you might even identify with certain parts of his journey. But first, let's talk to the current ladies and get their thoughts on those lofty sounding words, redemption and restoration. What are those? I wish there were other ways of saying those words, but I don't know any other words for that.
Well, you know, I had to look them up.
Oh, good.
Because I know what they mean, but I wanted a definition.
Yeah.
So all right, let's hear it.
I will share with you. So redeem is to gain or regain possession of something in exchange for payment.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And restore is to bring back, to reinstate.
Okay.
I like that.
Yeah. Okay.
And I looked up redeem too. I like it to be bought with a price.
Yes. Yes.
But that's just powerful. And I love it because it so represents what Christ did for us, right? Mm-hmm. We were so bought with price. And I like in one thing that I said, and now we're his own.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so warm and cuddly. Yeah. I love that.
That is neat.
And then the restoration, I think that might be easier to understand once we become new creations in Christ, new creatures in Christ, then God starts working on us and restoring us. It's that another big word that I don't even like to use it because it's such a churchy word, but sanctification, you know, it's a process of going from nothing to a place of holiness. God calls us to be holy. And I always used to wonder about that verse, be holy. It says, for I am holy, God's talking. And I thought, I can never be holy, but I can be in the process of going toward holiness. Right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. And it's a constant journey. I read a quote the other day that, you know, life, so many times we feel like, oh, it's a, you know, this process, like you said, sanctification, or it's this journey that we're on to become something. But really another perspective is unbecoming all those things that, you know, the world tries to throw all these things on you from a young age. And I think that's the enemy's job, to steal, kill, and destroy. And you know, especially the younger he can get us, the better in his book, because, you know, especially children that have gone through traumatic things, or if they've come from a broken home or went through abuse or whatever they went through, you have to unbecome all those things, all the lies, all the hurt, all the pain, all the disappointments, all the abuse. You have to shed all that stuff off as we become a new creature in Christ. It's not this instant thing that we feel like, oh, now I'm confident. I know who I'm in Christ. I know I'm loved. I'm whole. I'm walking in boldness and freedom. It's a journey. And I think it's so awesome just to give yourself that permission to go on it and bring as many people that you love with you, because what you begin to realize, it's getting back to where you originally were. So when you talk about redeeming something or restoring something, it's reinstating it to its original intent. And I believe when God brought us into this world, you know, as little babies, we're pure, you know, we don't have all the cares of the world on us yet. And then you start living and stuff starts happening. And so I think it's about unbecoming all of this stuff and becoming originally who you were called to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really odd for me, because when we were studying this last night, I was just going over that redemption and really trying to let it, because I keep hearing that song, I've been redeemed. Mm-hmm. You know that one?
Mm-hmm. Sing it to us.
Oh, yeah. I'll shake off these heavy chains.
Yes.
Wipe all these tears away. I mean, it's so powerful what God does for us when he takes hold of our life. But the word that kept coming to me was his grace.
Mm-hmm.
His grace, his redemption. And it reminded me of a story of this little boy who every day he went to school and he just was a tyrant. He was a young kid. He just always was doing something wrong, you know, and it shows you what happens when the enemy just lies to us and makes us feel unworthy. And so the principal would pull him into the office and give him a discipline. And this day he had come in, he had hit this little boy and put his head underneath a sandbox. Mm-hmm. And the principal looked at him. He says, do you not get in trouble all the time? He says, yeah, I do. And he says, and when you go to hit this kid, do you not think about you're going to get in trouble again? And the kid says, yes, but what do? He says, I take whatever you can give me. Mm. And the principal says, well, I'm going to tell you about grace today. And he goes, oh, so we're going to eat, we're going to pray, you know, because he's thinking it's grace. And he goes, no, he goes, let me show you what grace is. He goes, because you did do something wrong. So there is going to be a price to pay. Mm-hmm. He said, so he told the teacher, said, go get me the belt. So the kid, because then every time there's a slap, I want you to count one. And so he's like, oh, and he's sitting there thinking, okay, I'm ready to go. And the principal puts out his hands and goes, go. And the guy would slap him with the belt. And the kid would go, one. And then they'd slap again. And he'd go, two. And finally it got to like five. And the principal's just taking each slap. Mm. And he looks and he goes, stop, that's enough. He says, no. That's grace. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what it's about for us today, is even when we don't deserve God's grace, even when we don't deserve his redemption, it's still there for us. And he's ready if we'll just humble ourselves and say, take me. Mm-hmm. And he says, I want you as you are.
And why don't we live like that? That is such a beautiful word picture. I don't know why we don't grab hold of that truth, because it is there for us. And also, what are you doing with your children? You all have young children at home, Leanne, you have teenagers, but how are you teaching them about grace in their lives?
Well, you know, things happen. There's mean kids out there, and I always say you're only as happy as your saddest child. And so when something happens to one of your kids, you want to do something about it. And for the most part, they've, you know, kind of had unscathed, you know, childhoods. But we've had to talk through when there have been mean people, and how do you handle that? And our church talks a lot about grace. And so now that they're teenagers, they sit with us through the sermons. And we just say that, you know, the Bible says, you know, turn the other cheek, let them have the other side. You know, it's just crazy, but it's not easy, you know, especially as a parent. I think when somebody does something with your children, you really want to, you know, retaliate.
Sure.
But you've had to just say, like, listen, God's got this, you know, and not. And just give grace to other people. Because what I always tell them is, you just don't know what they're going through in their life. You don't know what's happening in their home. You don't know the hurts that are happening. And hurt people hurt people. Mm-hmm. And that's always important to remember.
I mean, that's good. Somebody told me the other day, too, you know, that quote, obviously, to gain that understanding, that perspective. But loved people, too. And I think one of the greatest things we can do for our children is, instead of taking on the spirit of perfectionism, it's just really receive God's grace and extend it to them, and teach them to extend it to themselves and to others, and not to be so hard on ourselves, and know that God, you know, can redeem time too. I want to encourage all of us and anybody that's gone through something traumatic in their life, where they feel like maybe years have gone by, or they've been going through a situation and, you know, a decade's gone by, or a broken relationship, that God knows how to make everything beautiful in this time, but he also knows how to redeem it. In other words, if you hear that saying, God will give you double for your trouble, I love that statement, because it's so true. God can restore exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or even think. So even if we feel that something is so lost and it's not repairable, God specializes in repairing and restoring in such a supernatural way. And that's only through his grace.
Well, and I love that quote, that sometimes good things must end so greater things can begin.
Ooh, that's good. That's
and
good.
Sometimes you have to be willing to let go of what's in your hands and let God redeem it so that greater things can happen. And
that's really good.
That doesn't make sense in our humanness, but we don't live in our humanness. We're walking in a spiritual life that God promises to make something beautiful out of everything that the devil meant for bad.
That's another song you should be singing. Something beautiful. Where is that, Carolyn?
Remember that song?
Yeah, do you?
Something beautiful. I remember that song.
Sing
I'm
it.
Aging myself. Something good. All my confusion, he understood. I'm not going to go anymore.
Oh, I love
that.
Oh,
wow.
Beautiful. Scripture. What else does Scripture have to say about redemption, restoring our lives in grace?
Do you I've got Ephesians 1:7 because my girl over here has it. We all pray the word, right?
Yeah.
It says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace.
Mm.
And when I think about the riches of his grace, that's unlimited resources that we're tapping into. God can never, he never has enough grace. It's not like, oh, you reached your limit for the day. He goes, no, but wait,
there's more.
And I think what our job as children of God is to posture ourselves to receive that.
Yes.
And I think one of the greatest tragedies in a Christian walk could be not receiving that grace to the full measure. Yeah. And when you've opened yourself up, and it's hard, we all know it's hard to surrender, it's hard to become vulnerable because you're broken, and especially when you've been violated or hurt or disappointed or abused, it's hard to trust again. But I want to encourage all of us, interviewers today, open your heart to trust again. God's grace is good, and it heals us in places we didn't even know we hurt. Mm. There's a lot of traumatic things that can happen to us, and sometimes, you know, we'll be going through a daily activity and something will trigger something up, and we didn't even know that we're still battling because we're retaliating out in anger or bitterness, and it's like, oh God, what is that part in me? He goes, I've got grace for that. Mm-hmm. Let my grace heal mm-hmm. that. Let my grace cover that. And that's what I want to encourage all of us, just to receive His
and
grace.
And letting our children gift. See us extend
yes,
grace.
Yes, receive that. Yeah. Yes.
Super important. I have yes. A verse from Psalm 103 that says, He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him.
That's good. Mm-hmm.
And that His love is greater. And our love for our kids, like you were saying, should be greater. Mm-hmm. than what they deserve.
And to understand, even at their young ages, Charlie's 9, 7, 5, those three, my three adorables, do they know what grace means? I mean, I'm sure they've seen it in your behavior with them. Do they actually know the term? I
think Charlie sometimes when he gets in trouble.
Show me grace.
Show me grace.
Give me
grace.
That's good.
They're like,
That is great. Well, we are in a position to be able to, as Courtney so beautifully said too, is just to be posture ourselves to receive God's grace, and that we all have been redeemed. We've been bought at a price. Right. We're in the process of being restored. We're not there yet, and that's okay. Yeah. And we're going to be hopefully extending grace and receiving grace for the rest of our lives. Courtney, how can our ladies, our friends, our gentlemen friends even get in touch with us here
Absolutely.
At the station?
Well, we'd love for you to join this conversation. How is God's grace working out healing and deliverance and freedom in your life? Make sure you go to our Facebook page and Instagram page. And know we want to get out of our set and into your community. We want to touch you and extend God's grace to you and just show you the goodness of God in the land of the living. So make sure you check out and see our next Current Ladies Night Out.
Thank you, ladies. That is great. Well, we've got a great story for you, a life-changing story. Our own producer here at Good Life 45. He's going to be telling you his story of redemption and restoration coming up here on Welcome Home. So stay with us.
You've probably heard that Harriet Tubman's portrait is going to be displayed on the new upcoming $20 bill. So I was excited to learn a little bit more about Harriet this week. Harriet Tubman earned the nickname Moses because she led so many slaves from the South to freedom before and during the Civil War. Harriet explained that her work, in fact her life's success, was due solely to steadfast prayer and her trust in God. At 14, Harriet began having visions and speaking with God regularly. The power of her life was rooted in her intimacy with Jesus through Holy Spirit, and she fought against injustice to serve other people. She shared that the Lord often gave her very specific instructions about what to do and not do, where to go and not go. In fact, the night that she gained her freedom, Harriet testified that God gave her supernatural strength and an understanding of the North Star displayed against an incredibly clear sky. With help from the Underground Railroad, she was able to make her way to freedom, and she had a real heart to guide others to do just the same. Harriet felt her role in the Underground Railroad was actually a personal directive from God. She first balked at the idea, telling the Lord that she didn't think she could do this, and would He please just use somebody else? God answered her, "It's you I want, Harriet." Though there was a reward out for her capture and it was very dangerous, Harriet kept on going back and forth, freeing hundreds of her fellow slaves in missions of deliverance, including her own mother and father. Her motto began, "I can't die but once." After the Civil War started, Harriet served as a nurse, a laundress, and even an active spy for the Federal Army. Despite numerous honors, she spent her last years in poverty, caring for the sick and elderly at a home that she opened in Auburn, New York. Harriet Tubman's in that great cloud of witnesses surrounding us as we run the race that God directs each of us to run. She encourages us to keep our eyes on Jesus, to be His hands and feet in this world. You know, it says, "In God we trust," on the back of the $20 bill. So it seems all too fitting to have Harriet's picture on the other side.
What a joy it is to be able to talk about redemption and how God has paid the price for all of our sins, for our lives, and then He's in the business of restoring our lives. And we're going to hear today a life-changing story about that very thing. We have our own producer from here on Welcome Home, here at Good Life 45, the one, the only, he likes to call himself the legacy.
Legend.
The legend, the legendary Doug Prusak. Thank you, Doug, for being here with us
Absolutely.
Today. Now, you've got a story to tell. We all have stories to tell, but we've been focusing today on redemption and restoration. How was Doug Prusak redeemed?
Wow. wow. Everything that God had taken from me in He has restored, and then some. Mm-hmm. And I grew up just outside of Boston in a family that was emotionless, and I was expected to do things, and there was no love, support mm-hmm. kind of thing. You were just expected to fall into mm-hmm. a line.
Where do you think that came from?
That's a tough answer because I would go down the path of mental illness and control mm-hmm. and a certain narcissistic mm-hmm. tendency. And I was a very independent child. Just, I did my own thing. I had my own beat.
Well, you had to, right? If you weren't getting any support from your parents.
I learned at a young age that I was alone, mm-hmm. even when I had people yeah. around. And there were several instances in my childhood that really brought that out. But it really hit its apex when I was getting in my first marriage and I took a job in another state. I worked in television for 30 years, and it was the beginning of my career. And television's an industry where you bounce around. If you spend 20 or 30 years in one city, you're very lucky. Mm-hmm. And I've lived in every city on the East Coast. And I had taken a job. I started working in Boston, my hometown. I took a job just in Washington, D.C. in 1990. And when I took that job, it was the same year I was having my first marriage. And my parents weren't thrilled with either.
Hmm.
And
did you feel like you had to please your parents, or were you putting up an emotional barrier because you weren't receiving any kind of reciprocal feelings?
It was a pleasing thing.
Okay.
It was a pleasing thing. I mean, I knew very early on I wasn't going to stay mm-hmm. in my hometown.
Mm-hmm.
It was a small town. I still have great friends there, but it just was,
yeah.
I needed out.
Right.
And I went to Boston University, got a job right out of an internship. I was hired on my graduation day. And one thing led to another, and a couple of years later, an opportunity came up. Well, that was, you know, me forging my career, making my own life decisions. And it wasn't pleasing to my parents.
What did your parents want you to do?
Stay local.
Okay.
Stay local, marry the local girl.
But they didn't care about what job you were in, just so you
really
stay local.
They really didn't.
Okay.
And that was hard.
Yeah.
Because I had found something I loved doing, producing mm-hmm. television. I was very blessed to be able to do it while I was in college. And I got the opportunity, I took it, and I was getting married the same year. And before I left to take that job, I had some conversations with my dad. And my dad had said, you know, you're going against your mother's plan for your life. And it really didn't resonate with me. I didn't stop to think about it. I just knew that this was what I had to do to progress my career. I'm building my own life. Well, I moved, and about 6 weeks before we got married, I got a letter from my mother that said, basically, I'm done with you, don't call, don't write.
Mm.
That was 26 years ago.
Mm. Well, do you remember what you felt when you read a letter like that? This is your mother, your flesh and blood, somebody who gave birth to you, and she's basically disowning you for going against her wishes.
Yeah. It's empty. I'd always felt to a certain degree that I was alone. You know, at the time, God wasn't a part of my life, I believed, but it was something that...
Head knowledge.
It was head knowledge. Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And...
So are you angry when you read the letter? Are you putting up an emotional barrier? Are you sad by it? What are you?
I was angry.
Angry.
I was angry because, you know, you expect your parents to be with you
sure.
no matter what.
Support you,
you know,
no matter what
you do, your parents are with you.
Right.
And it wasn't there.
Yeah.
And
so you write them off at that point?
They didn't come to the wedding.
Wow.
That job lasted about 11 months mm-hmm. and two states and a whole lot of shenanigans. And we moved back to Boston and there was no contact. Mm-hmm. And as the years went on, you know, four, five, 6 years, you just start to realize this is for real.
Mm-hmm.
And it was funny, at one point I actually worked in the same building as my father.
Wow.
About 7 years after this all happened.
Were there other siblings around?
I have a younger brother.
And did they treat him the same way as they treated you?
Nope. He
was the golden child.
He drank the Kool-Aid. He was on the party line.
Okay.
I had asked him to be my best man, and he said no.
Wow, Doug.
So it was just one of those things that, as the years went on, you just mm-hmm. start to push it away.
Sure.
You just start to let it go because you realize that this isn't normal, mm-hmm. first of all.
Right.
Second of all, you realize you've still got your own life, your own family, and you've got to make your own decisions.
Well, and you could have numbed the pain in a lot of ways that you chose not to. Mm-hmm. You could have become an alcoholic, a drug addict. You know, there are a lot of things that people do to numb that kind of rejection and pain. What was your drug of choice?
Just putting my head down and keep going.
Yeah, work.
Just work. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had it, you know, I was trying to forge a career.
I was,
you know, went from Boston to Miami, Washington, D.C., you know, worked in New Jersey for a while. Mm-hmm. You just put your head down and try to build your career in your own life.
Yeah.
That really was it. I mean, there's no mm-hmm. vice. I mean, my biggest vice is golf.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not a drinker. I don't smoke. There was nothing strange.
But don't you think that people subconsciously choose something to numb that kind of pain?
Oh, absolutely.
And yours was just maybe a busy lifestyle and how fortunate you are not to have gone down other pathways that you could have gone down?
Absolutely.
I mean, God's protection, would you call it that?
God has protected me in so many different ways, even before I came to know him.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just, when I look back on my life, when you do the mm-hmm. timeline of everything that's mm-hmm. happened, and even before I accepted Christ,
yeah.
God protected
right.
me. I
right.
could have gotten into so many different things all along.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, television's a tough business. There's a lot of alcoholism. There's a lot of drug use.
Sure.
There's a lot of, you know, infidelity. Mm-hmm. It's just, there's a lot of things that you can get into, and I was very blessed not to be.
Right.
And as the years go on, when, you know, your parents walk away from you, then your marriage falls apart,
mm-hmm.
and you start looking at other things, and there's options out there.
Sure.
And he kept me from all of them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this relationship with your wife went south.
South.
But you had a couple of kids.
Mm-hmm.
We won't talk about what happened. The dissolution of the marriage happens many to 50% mm-hmm. of the population, but that gives you the freedom to start a new life. So where do you go after the marriage is over and the kids are, everybody's living, I think, by that time in Atlanta?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're all in the Atlanta area. I have two great kids. My mm-hmm. son's now 19, Terry, and my daughter Kaylee is a high school senior. And it was difficult. It was difficult because in a lot of traditional divorces, you have, you know, the weekend custody kind of handoff deal. I work nights and weekends.
Mm.
And that made it hard in terms of seeing them. So, you know, we have our divorce. I'm in Atlanta for the next 5 years. You know, got into another relationship that ended in questionable circumstances as well. And you just realize that even though you're with people, you're alone.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just, I always felt a distance, even when I was involved.
Because you're feeling this void, and the void is obviously no Jesus
in
your
life. There's
no Jesus. Right?
You know, and you know, when your parents reject you, and you know, your wife divorces you, and you have another long-term relationship that ends the way it did, you start to wonder.
Sure.
You start to receive what you're hearing, that people don't want you around. And it's just, you know, you just, the heck with it. I mean, why bother letting anybody else in?
Yeah.
And at the end of that other relationship was also my time in Atlanta. And God brought me to Orlando about 7 years ago. And I honestly think when I look back on it, he gave me time to get myself, my head right. He grabbed my heart to get with him and just start growing as a Christian. And everything else was kept away. I had my life, I had my job, my golf. If I wasn't at work, I was probably at the range. Just, you know, it was a place for me to be.
Safe place.
A safe place for me to be. It was very therapeutic. There's a lot to be said for a bucket of balls and an 8-iron.
Sure.
there just is.
A lot of aggression that can be played out.
You could get rid of a lot.
Yes.
And you just, it's a solitude, and you're just there, and you know, you're just hitting balls, and it was an escape.
So after that, you're starting to grow in the Lord yet? How did you come to this relationship with Jesus Christ?
Well, God had just brought me here, and I had taken a job at one of the local news stations. And it was a couple of months after I got here, and one of my coworkers asked me to take a walk. And we wound up in the garage for the building. A lot, you know, history-changing things happen in garages. Watergate, my life,
yeah,
you know.
Right.
And I was asked a bunch of questions, and the last question was, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? And I had a smart aleck answer on the tip of my tongue because, well, I was just me. But I didn't say it. I said, no, I don't. And I was given some books and some things to look at and read. And in all honesty, in the beginning, it was more of an academic thing for me.
Exploration, discovery.
Because I needed to understand. I started reading everything I could get my hands on. You know, I had people giving me books, and it was a huge blessing to me because I had to understand the basics.
Do you remember if there was a turning point where the light actually went on and you said, yes, there is a God. Yes, I do want Jesus as my Lord and Savior.
Yeah, I do. I had been, you know, kind of church shopping, and I was over at Northland, and it was just, it was great for me because it was anonymous. I could go in.
Sure.
I could, you know, worship and get out. And it was a safe place for me because I wasn't getting approached by anybody, and you know, it worked. And a couple of months after I had that conversation, I did the salvation prayer there.
You went up to the altar? Was there an altar call?
Altar call.
You actually walk forward?
You go walk forward.
By yourself.
And Pastor Joel, Pastor Joel did the salvation prayer, and there was about 30 of us. And it just clicked.
Yeah.
That was the moment for me that it was like, okay, this is where I'm supposed to be. And nothing happened in my life. The restoration didn't begin until that moment. He was working on me. He was cleaning me up. I was learning. And I did that.
Redeemed. There's
redeemed.
The first R. You were redeemed. And now
right
we're going to talk about the restoration.
It was redeemed right there. And I remember because it's so unlike me to get up in front of people. To put myself in a spotlight. I'm very happy behind the scenes.
Right.
That's why I've been a producer.
Exactly.
So it's like,
well, this is very painful for you. You've known for a long time that you needed to tell
to
your story.
This.
I've had to be on you about it. You've not wanted to tell your story.
You've been on me about it for 3 years. And, you know, here we are.
Right.
But it was that moment that Pastor Joel was praying over all of us. And, you know, we do the salvation prayer and everybody in the church applauds. And I'm thinking, I'm in public in front of people doing this, and I'm looking around like, who's with me? I'm not alone, right?
Right.
And but at that moment, there was just a peace that, okay, this is the path. This is it. And it was exciting because, and I didn't even realize the full scope of what I had yet. I just realized this is what I wanted.
Yeah.
And I remember leaving church that night and going back to my apartment and thinking, okay, this is, there's something else. There's something working here. And I just let it soak for a few days. And that was, it was an incredible experience. It was just, I just felt different.
Were there any doubts? You know, a lot of times people will have that salvation experience where they've prayed to receive Christ and, you know, there's an explosion in your spirit and then you go home and you're like, whoa, what did I just do? What happened? You weren't there. You didn't ever do that.
It wasn't so much the what did I do as in what's next.
Ah, that's good.
Because
that's good.
I'm basically alone mm-hmm. in Orlando. There's no family here. Mm-hmm. There's no nothing.
It's just work.
It was work and golf and
right.
And I didn't know what to do next. Mm. I didn't have somebody come alongside me right away and say, okay, you've just done the salvation prayer.
Yeah.
Here are your next steps. Yeah. I didn't have that.
Right.
So there was probably a 5 or 6 month period where it really could have gone either way. Mm. I was eager. I wanted to learn. I wanted to learn more about the Lord. I wanted to get deeper into it, but I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
So that went on for a little while, and then a couple of things happened that really gave my walk shape. I took a class at Calvary Assembly called Cleansing Stream, and the idea of the class is that you are a new man in Christ, the past is gone, and here's your path forward. Mm-hmm. And it was an 8-week class, and it ended with a retreat. And that retreat was over on the other side of the state, and it was where I heard God speak to me for the first time. Hmm. And or that I recognized him. You know, he spoke to me and the things that he did in my life and where he was taking
right.
me, but to actually hear his voice and know who it was.
Audibly? You're hearing audibly his voice?
Audibly. Okay. His voice for the first time. And the retreat weekend started off on a Friday night, and there was this wonderful pastor there who shared a story about his life and all he went through. And then he started asking questions. Are you alone now? Mm-hmm. Have you been rejected by your parents?
Wow.
Have you been rejected by a spouse?
Check.
Have
check,
you exactly.
Check.
You know, do you feel like you have to do everything yourself?
Wow.
Do you, there were 8 questions.
Wow.
And I answered all 8 of them. Yes.
Wow.
Well, he finishes the list and he says, mm. So how many of you answered? And, you know, people raise their hands. How many? You know, 1, 2, 3. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, if you answered any of these questions, he said, you have the orphan heart.
Hmm. Orphan heart.
Orphan heart. Mm-hmm. And I'd never heard the term before.
Yeah.
And I just remember thinking, okay, my 30 years away from being in a church, mm. I had been raised Catholic but left when I was 15 because of a retreat weekend, mm-hmm. ironically. And so that 30-year journey comes on, and we get through it, and he says, you have the orphan heart. So then they dismiss us in the back of the church, and there's prayer. And I go up to the prayer leader, and he asked me, he said, how many questions did you answer? I said, 8. Hmm. And he said, how many? And I said, 8, all of them. Mm-hmm. And he walks away, comes back with these 2 other guys, and they form a circle around me, and they pray over me. And he said, from here on, you're a new man in Christ. Mm-hmm. The past is gone. Mm-hmm. It's over. Mm-hmm. You have a new life. You have a new family. You have a new father.
Wow. Wow. That took care of all the 8 boxes, right?
All 8 of the boxes.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, you have a new father. You have a new family. And I go back to my chair, and I just started praying. And what I was doing was just soaking in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, I heard him say, I love you, son. You are not alone.
Wow.
And he said it 3 times to make sure I heard it. And I just, that was a moment. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was just one of those moments along the way that
it was a defining moment in your Christian walk.
It really was.
Right.
But I also didn't quite understand what it meant to be his son.
Yeah.
And afterward, when I shared that story with some of the folks at the cleansing stream, they said, you realize you're one of his children, mm-hmm. not your earthly father who walks away from you. Mm-hmm. You're his child.
Right.
And that is, that just changed everything.
Yeah.
Because all the things that you hear, you're not good enough this, you're not, you know, this, and mm-hmm. all that, you internalize all that. No more. Mm-hmm. Now you internalize that you're his son, and all of that goes away. And it was just...
Well, it's life-changing. It really is.
Totally.
For the first time I heard that I was a daughter of the king, mm-hmm. thought, whoa, that means I'm royalty. That means somebody really cherishes me mm-hmm. and treasures my existence, and that I deserve more than mediocrity. And, you know, for you to be called a son, that you have this father, and your father's a king. I mean, I think that's life-changing for everybody, if everybody can really hear that message and believe it.
If you embrace that message, it
you
changes
live differently.
Everything.
Well,
it's
you
a
live
different
differently.
Life.
You yeah. have a different perspective. Okay, let's go on to the time where you meet Lisa, and then I want to hear about all the ways that God has restored, because you've lost everything.
Everything.
And now you go forward.
The first step in the restoration was parents. How many people get adopted when they're 45 years old? Through the folks at Calvary Assembly, I was introduced to this couple, Richard and Sonny Pratt, pretty much the same age as my biological parents. They're both amazing people of God. He's a prophet. Mm-hmm. He's spoken over me more times than I can count, and they've all come true, mm-hmm. everything. Mm-hmm. They came into my life. I'm very close to them in a lot of ways. They haven't officially adopted me. I mean, there's mm-hmm. no legal paperwork, but I call them mom and dad.
Sure.
So that was the first part of the restoration. And then soon after that, I met Lisa. And there's no question in my mind that that was God bringing us together.
Right.
Because we knew right away. Mm-hmm. We knew the night we met, this is it.
Mm. Wow.
And there are not words for that. Mm-hmm. But what I do remember is I was waiting for her, and I saw her coming, and God spoke to me again.
Wow.
He said, done deal.
Wow. 6 months later, you married her.
We married.
And this is how many years ago now?
4 years ago.
4 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, God gave me one of his best.
Yep.
He really did.
She is. She's a good one.
Selfless. Mm-hmm. Heart of gold, can't do enough for everybody, mm-hmm. and I'm still waiting for her to put herself first once. Mm. She hasn't done it. And I got to see firsthand what it's like to be the hands and feet of Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I, you know, God has taught me those lessons through the people he's put in my life.
Sure.
And to have new parents mm-hmm. and a new bride, mm-hmm.
It is serious restoration, and your story, Doug, reminds me a lot of Job. Job mm-hmm. lost everything. Mm-hmm. You lost everything, but what you got after that redemption, and as a part of the process, you've got Lisa now. You've got parents. You've got kids now. Mm-hmm. You've got kids that love you. Lisa's kids love you. Your kids love you. And tell us about the third set of kids that love you.
Oh, my goodness. but Lisa and I attend church together, Pastor Andy Searles. And also at that church was a grandmother and a mother and these two sweet little girls. And last November, the mom died. Just suddenly, she just passed. Grandma's doing the best she can, and you know she's had some health issues as well. So we're attending school sporadically, and you know, it was just really it was a tough situation. And God put it on our hearts to get involved. Well, Lisa gets involved. She dives in head first. Christmas is coming, mm-hmm. and she gets them connected with some great folks at St. Luke's over in Oviedo. They put them on the Angel Tree. A couple of other organizations got involved. Lisa put up an Amazon site with some of the toys they wanted. Our church rallied around them and bought the list before she could finish building it. They had the biggest Christmas ever. Lisa takes them to and from school and, you know, gets them in their activities. And it's just been, an eye-opening experience just to be able to be as blessed as we are to give back like that.
Right. So you go from two kids who really are living with their mom and that you rarely see your own biological kids to now having a great relationship with your biological kids and Lisa's two kids and these two little girls
who
needed a new mom and dad.
Yep.
Amazing.
It is.
And but you've put yourself out there too, Doug. You've allowed this to happen. You could have said no to all this and you were at least obedient and opened up your heart and your life.
It wasn't hard because, you know, it's a haunting thing to remember, but to whom much is given, much is expected. That's scary.
Yeah.
And you don't realize, okay, so he has blessed you with so much. What's enough?
Right.
When do you say when?
Yeah.
And this opportunity came up, and to watch these two little girls and to be able to do for them and get them the things that they need to succeed is powerful.
Yeah.
And to have God put you in a position to be able to do that, it's still a bit for me to go home and see these two girls there.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, okay, Terry, Kaylee, Lisa's kids, John and Katie, yeah, they're okay. Now it's 5 and 6.
Yeah.
Oh, and a dog. So it's a lot.
It's a lot.
But you know, we've been blessed. God's, you know, restored so much.
And the verses I know that come to mind, Doug, that you've looked up and that we've talked about together, that God's going to restore what the locusts have taken away, and that He takes ashes and He makes beauty out of your life. We have you here at Good Life 45 as a Christian producer at a Christian television station that I know in your background, you never in a million years thought you would be someplace like this. And you're incredibly effective with us and are a blessing to so many. So I know there's more to the story. We're out of time.
It's okay.
You're an amazing example of God's redemptive power and restoration. So thanks for being obedient. Thanks for being here with us today. Look forward to every day that we work together. And viewers, we thank you for being a part of our program today. I hope that Doug's story has been an encouragement to you and to understand how we are all redeemed. God, Christ, Jesus paid a price for us for our sins when He died on the cross. Here's an example, a life-changing story of a man who has been redeemed. I hope that's been a part of your story as well. And then to see how God can restore a life and bring you to a place of great victory and fruition. So thanks for being with us today and hearing Doug's story. Stay with us because we've got more coming up. We are in the kitchen with John Rivers. What is cooking today, John Rivers?
How are you,
always
dear?
Glad Thank to have you,
you
in the
me.
Kitchen.
Thank you so
what
much.
What are we fixing today?
We're going to have some breakfast this morning.
Okay, good.
And it's so funny how many people struggle with the simple thing of scrambling eggs and making an omelet.
Yes.
So I thought, even though it was a basic, we're going to start with that because that's the best way to start the day.
Good. That is the only thing my daughter knows how to cook. She's recently married and she does know how to scramble an egg, but nothing else. But that is a basic thing that everybody should
it
know
is.
How to do,
it
right?
Is.
All right, so what should we do?
Okay, so we're going to start with 3 eggs. Now, we used a farm-raised eggs because they will make a little bit difference in the taste versus what you get at, say, a supermarket.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to put just a little bit of cream or half and half or milk in it.
Mm.
And what that does, that helps the eggs get a little bit creamier. Now, while this is doing this, I have some butter.
Yes.
I'm going to melt over here.
And so always real butter.
So it's nice, absolutely nice and hot for us. I'm going to add just a pinch of salt.
Now, is that coarse salt, any kind of weird salt that you use?
No, that's just a regular
salt.
Typically, I'll use a kosher salt because I like it a little bit thicker, but
not
today we're just doing that. A little bit of pepper, and I found a couple of little seasonings. This one's called a camp mix, and you can get it in town.
Okay.
And it's just got some wonderful flavors to it, and a little bit of hot sauce, okay?
Yes.
And you can't really taste it, but it gives it some nice balance.
Okay.
And I put everything in before I mix it up.
And why is that?
So that it distributes evenly.
Okay.
And remember, what we'll do is it's important to put the spices in on the front end before you cook it because all the heat actually releases the flavors of the spicing.
Oh, I didn't
know
that.
So if you wait until the end, you won't get the benefit of it.
Very good.
Right. My butter is nice and hot.
Okay.
I'm mixing this, and it's really important when you mix it, you want to get some air in there.
Well, you could use a whisk, right?
But you could.
I don't have a whisk.
We don't have a whisk with us. And
this is the air between the prongs of the fork. We're fine.
And it does just fine.
Right, absolutely.
That air is what helps it get nice and fluffy.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I've got it mixed. Now, I like a little bit of cheese in mine. So
cheddar.
I'm going to put a little cheddar in there.
Love it.
Okay, now, there's a two-step process to doing scrambled eggs. You start on a really, really high. Okay, right in your butter.
Okay.
And that's really, really high.
Is this not an omelet? This is really scrambled,
this is supposed
right?
to, yeah, this is going to be scrambled. That is okay. really super high.
Yeah.
And you, what you do instead of, you know, I remember my mom making these, and God bless her, when she makes scrambled eggs, she would put, crack the eggs right in here and just scramble the heck out of them.
Bless and, your mom and bless but, me too, because that's the way I do it.
Now, what we're doing is just, it's a nice gentle, you know, just turning it over.
Okay.
Because I want it to be light and I want it to be fluffy.
But it almost looks like an omelet that you're doing. A messed up omelet?
It does. Like a, we're going to do an omelet next, and that might be scrambled.
Okay.
That doesn't quite go so well.
Wow, I've never seen that.
So you're doing it in two phases. You start it really high.
Yes.
Okay. And you let it kind of, you know, get the bottom of it really cooked. And then about 70% of the way through, you move it to a lower temp.
Okay.
Okay. And then you're finishing it real gentle. You see how nice and fluffy everything mm-hmm. is?
Yeah. Yes.
And then, because you don't want it to be hard, and you don't want
right.
it to be dry.
Right.
And this keeps it really, you know, into a pretty, pretty egg.
That's beautiful.
Isn't that nice?
Uh-huh.
My cheese is melting in there. And then it's just really, you know, depending on how much, how long, how well done you want your eggs.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people don't like them runny, especially when they're scrambled. So I'll let
how
it go.
How do you like yours? Medium?
My scrambled, I don't like them runny.
Okay.
You know, but my other eggs, I definitely like them to have some nice run in it. And that is really it. See how pretty it is?
Well, and you don't chop it all up? Like
no.
to make it look scrambled?
No. No, I'm going to serve it just like that.
Okay.
Now, another thing that's important is to see the size of the pan that I
yes.
used. If I used a bigger pan like we're going to do here for
yes.
the omelets, okay?
You're not going to get that.
You won't get that
omelet
lift,
yes.
right? Because it's cooking and building on top
right.
of each other. And then we'll put it on our plate.
Now, is three eggs generally what people would eat for one serving?
You know, I do. That's what we serve at the coop.
Okay.
And, you know, the other option is two eggs if you're really not that hungry, but that's
lovely.
A hearty.
Very,
you know,
very nice.
Put a little bit of pepper on top
uh-huh.
and a little bit of chives. And,
okay.
You know, and...
You made that look awfully easy. Awfully easy. Now, the bacon, are you doing bacon in a microwave or
a trick
bacon?
To bacon so you don't make a mess
yeah.
is you put it in your oven. You put it on a flat pan,
okay.
and you put some aluminum foil on the top of it, and
nice.
Put it in the oven, and it's so it takes like 30 minutes. You know, cook it about 425.
30 minutes, John, that's a long time for breakfast, right? No? Okay. And this is Saturday and Sunday, probably, when you have a little more time.
When you have
this
a little bit more time.
Yeah. I'm sort of a microwavable type of girl.
Oh, that's
sorry.
So funny.
Yeah. But right. that's lovely.
Well, now, let's do an omelet.
Okay.
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 Now, this omelet is a Greek omelet, and this came from my daughter one Saturday morning. She wakes up. And she's all grumpy and everything. And she says, "Dad, you know, can you make me some breakfast?" And I love it when she says that.
Yes.
And I absolutely,
yes,
honey, I'm happy to.
Mm-hmm.
And what would you like? She said, "Just anything you find in the refrigerator."
Wow.
I said,
nice.
"You got it." So
nice.
The night before we had a party.
Uh huh.
And these are a little Greek little spinach and phyllo, and I'm going to try to pronounce it.
Okay.
Spanakopita.
Something like that. Yeah. Spanakopita, very good.
And they're wonderful little hors d'oeuvres. So I'm going to take those. I had some of those left over. And I'm going to go ahead and chop those up.
Oh, wow.
And what's
okay.
nice is you get the spinach, you get the phyllo,
yeah.
and you also get, you know, the cheese that's
feta
in there.
Cheese,
the feta
right.
cheese,
so. And so these are already done. We don't have to have these. These were from the party.
That's
they
right.
You just bought them packaged.
They're there.
Ready to go.
Okay, now we're going to put our eggs in.
This is the same recipe for the scrambled egg.
The exact
that you just
same
did.
That I did
okay.
before.
I love
okay.
that you put half and half in. I would never have thought of that. I always just put eggs, plain milk.
Gives it a little bit of creaminess.
Yes.
Okay. We've got a super hot fire here, so
mm-hmm.
I'm going to move it over just a little bit. Now, different from a scrambled egg,
mm-hmm.
okay, what you do with an omelet, you want to keep it all together.
Yes.
Okay. So you're going to push up the edges, and as I push up this edge, I'm going to tilt the skillet toward me.
Okay.
I'm going to push up this edge. And tilt the skillet that way.
I wondered how you got all that stuff in the middle to cook.
And you get it all
so
underneath
just, okay.
it. Okay. See? And there's no rush.
Wow.
You know, if you feel that it's moving too fast or if it's burning on you, then just, you know, take it off the heat just
yeah.
like we did.
Okay.
And just take your time.
Yeah.
And let it go.
How lucky is Cameron to have her father be John Rivers? I mean, to be able to wake up in the morning and be Cameron Rivers and say, "Dad, would you just fix me anything you want?"
Mm.
Lucky girl.
Oh, lucky
right?
dad. Are you kidding?
Oh,
to be
I
able
know.
To cook for my daughter.
I know.
And to be able to create. And she's got an exploratory palate, too, which.
That's nice. How did you do that?
You know, from very young. Both of our children, we always had at least a one taste rule. You know, you don't have to eat it.
I like
but
that.
At least taste it.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
And,
are you having that rule with me too? Probably. Because John, I already told John I'm not crazy about eggs, but I'll have the one taste rule.
It's coming toward you.
All right.
All right. So we've got that. Now we've got to add our insides.
Okay.
And that's on a nice, it's just cooking.
Okay.
Now one trick, you want to put all of your insides on one side.
Yes.
Okay, because I'm going to flip the other side.
Right.
So I'm going to put my my spinach in there.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to put a little bit of feta cheese. That's Greek,
right.
You know, and it goes with our Greek omelet.
Mm-hmm.
And literally, we made this up on the fly, you know, when we were doing it that day.
Made it up.
And I'm going to put some tomatoes in there, you know, to give it a little bit of life, and a little bit of Greek seasoning, you know, so it has a little bit more of that Greek flair to it.
So what did Cameron give this?
Oh, she loved it.
It was a chicken.
She loved it, yes.
Right?
And then she was quite disappointed when we ran out of the little spinach cakes. Now, what you do here is you take it and you just fold it over.
Okay.
Nice, and it's really easy.
Lovely.
Okay. Now, you're also noticing how easy it's going over for me.
Uh-huh.
That's because I'm using a coated pan.
And butter.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. The
right.
coated
Two
pan
together.
Makes the world of difference.
Good combination.
Yeah. And you're not going to try to flip this because everything will go out on you.
Okay.
And you see how pretty that sits?
Wow.
Okay.
That's lovely.
Now, to serve it, I would let it cook for a little bit longer because you want all that cheese inside to melt.
Right.
But
right.
I'm going to go ahead and we'll bring this one out.
Okay.
And that coat of pan is just going to allow you also just to slide it off nicely.
It doesn't even fall apart.
No.
Wow.
Okay.
If this could only happen at the Beck House, I'd be so happy.
And I tell you what, let's go ahead and dress this up a little bit.
All right. A little more cheese on top.
I think a little cheese on top.
Okay.
Make it really pretty. You know, people like that, you know, that texture when they see it.
Certainly.
And I got a little tzatziki sauce because it's Greek and
tzatziki?
It kind of goes with it. Yes.
Is it like a what is that?
It's going to be like a sour cream base.
Oh. Oh, John, this is bad. This is bad, but this is so good. Well, we're about out of time, so may I go ahead and have a quick taste? Little chives on top.
You may now.
All right, let me taste.
All right.
And this is from somebody who does not like eggs, so this better be good, John Rivers. I'm telling you, I want to get into the good stuff here.
That's how funny.
This is going to be yummy, or else it's hot. I think I like eggs.
Mission accomplished.
Very good. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
You're so
welcome. Recipe will be on our Facebook page, so go and check it out.
I'm laughing because I have so many people come to me and say, I know I'm called, but no one seems to notice. Or I get this, I'm anointed, why won't they use me? Then they'll say, I'm available, why won't they give me an opportunity? It's like the guy who comes to church with a guitar strapped to his back. When asked to sing and play, he says, oh, no, I didn't come prepared. Have you ever met anyone like that? You have talents and accomplishments, but where's the opportunity? Friend, one of the most important aspects of anyone's calling is timing. And God is all about times and seasons. King Solomon said, to everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. I love that. I can just hear someone saying, but when is my time coming? And one of the most difficult aspects of this is dealing with delay. No one likes delay. We want the answer. However, delay is part of the process. It's very easy to be filled with anger and become bitter with those that don't recognize your gifting. But that is your enemy. My husband used to say this. Now follow me. God fixes a fix to fix you. And if you unfix the fix before you're fixed, he'll just fix another fix to fix you. Remember what I said before? Delay is part of the process. And most of the time in delay, that process is fixing us. But what do you do in that time of delay? Well, first of all, I would suggest that you prepare. Begin a strategy to learn and develop your gift and your calling. Of course, I recommend Faith Christian University because it was founded for people just like you. To educate, equip, and empower new believers and pastors and all Christian leaders to approach the delay as an opportunity of preparation. Live every day intentionally is another excellent one. Keep your dreams in focus and walk out each day with vision and purpose. Then I would suggest find a place to serve. Be committed, faithful, stay humble. be teachable, and determined to always be an asset to anyone else's ministry. I would look for opportunities to practice and exercise my gift. You desire to preach? Well, let me tell you a story of Billy Graham, that as a young man, he would go out by the river over in Tampa, Florida, where he was in Bible school, and he would put his Bible on a stump of a tree, and he would preach to the animals in the forest. But continue to develop your faith and keep believing. Don't ever give up. As you develop your faith, Romans 5:2 says, you will have access to the grace you need to endure during the time of delay. And then you will fulfill your calling. I believe that every believer is called, maybe not behind the pulpit or to be a missionary, but you're called to serve in the kingdom. We would be honored if you would allow Faith Christian University to invest in you and enrich and inspire your life and perfect your ministry calling. Go to our website that you see on the screen or either call us at 407-382-9477. God bless you.
You know, I love hearing stories of God's power in our lives, particularly when it involves someone I actually work with and spend a lot of time with each day. It's good to remember and reflect on ways that God has changed all of our lives and brought us from places of brokenness to wholeness in Christ. There's a verse in Scripture, Isaiah 61:3, that talks about beauty for ashes and then how our lives can be trees of righteousness. That, to me, is a great visual for all of our lives. If we look back and are honest, there are times when we are nothing but the devastation of ashes, burnout, tired, worthless, despondent, maybe even at the bottom of that pit that we live in from time to time. But Scripture promises us that we can be trees of righteousness. Now, that doesn't mean perfection. That doesn't happen on this planet. But it does mean being in right standing with God. And when we're in that position, we're strong in Christ. We're full of worth, good fruit, living lives of purpose and victory. That's available to each one of us. Let's commit today to stand on God's promises, to really allow Him to rebuild our lives and shape us into the new creatures in Christ that He intended us to be, serving well and loving others along the way. We've been redeemed and restored. Now let's live like it. And that's our note of hope for today. Thanks so much for watching, and may God richly bless you today.